take 14.
Okay, let's do it.
Any place is paradise when I'm with you. Maybe I'd live deep in the jungle and sleep up in a tree and let the rest of the world go by if you were there with me, where I can love you all the time. Maybe the jungle would be fine. Any place is paradise when I'm with you.
The movies. In the 1940s, that was the stuff that dreams were made of. And that's where Elvis Presley first glimpsed another kind of life. A celluloid world of drama, romance, happy endings, and endless possibilities. It was a life that stood in stark contrast to his own small-town existence. A life the young boy from Tupelo, Mississippi, desperately wanted to live. More than anything else in the world, Elvis Presley wanted to be an actor. As a teenager, he even got a job working as a movie theater usher. A first tentative step toward finding his dream. But Hollywood was a long way from the South, and Elvis Presley turned to music. ...1956 was the year Elvis got his first taste of glory. The young boy with magic in his eyes had arrived, and virtually the entire teenage population of America went wild.
Tell me what was on. 1956 was a great year. It really was. I mean, it was a great year. In this time period, we were basically talking about the crowds had gotten very large. The crowd gets so loud, the best way I can describe it is like when you dive into the water and you hear the phasing, the rush of the water, and it would get so loud that it would just cancel out all the sound on stage. Actually, on most songs, if we couldn't hear him, we'd know where he was at by his body language. And that's where I coined the phrase, we're probably the only band that I know literally directed by an ass.
Money high. Money high. Money high. If you wanna get it on.
Thank you very much, friends.
Elvis Presley was 21 years old and riding the crest of a teenage tidal wave. Ironically, it was his unprecedented popularity as a singer that caught the attention of the motion picture industry. When Hollywood came calling, Elvis Presley was ready.
Doing records is one thing, doing concerts is another thing. Doing television, it was a nice medium. It was not major motion pictures. When you're doing major motion pictures, only one place in the world to do them, and that's Hollywood. And Elvis had dreamed of being a movie star. And so consequently, when we got out here in Sunset Boulevard and Hollywood and Vine and, you know, the Derby and Beverly Hills and all that stuff, man, we just ate it up.
It was a self-styled Southern colonel named Tom Parker who set the stage for Elvis's Shot at Hollywood. Back in 1955, the colonel had promised to turn Elvis Presley's $1 million worth of talent into $1 million. That promise was the foundation of one of the most successful artist-manager relationships in the history of the entertainment business.
The Colonel lived and breathed Elvis 24 hours a day. And when people in the business would come to him and ask whether he wouldn't manage them, and he would say, no, my artist is Elvis. This is the only artist. I don't manage anybody else.
On Sunday morning, April 1st, 1956, Elvis arrived at the Paramount Studio offices of Hal Wallace. Mr. Wallace was one of Hollywood's most respected producers, and Elvis had come to film a screen test.
He was the only producer I've ever known who lied upwards about the cost of a picture. But his biggest talent was recognizing talent before it was recognized by the world. That's why he wanted to sign Elvis very early, and in effect did.
Despite an unfamiliar environment, his inexperience, and a prop guitar with no strings, Elvis pulled it off.
Well, it's one for the money, two for the show. Three to get ready now, go, cat, go. But don't you step on my blue suede shoe. Well, you can do anything but take me over my blue suede shoe. Well, you can knock me down, step in my face, slander my name all over the place. Well, do anything that you want to do, but not, honey, lay off.
Elvis was totally unaware of the playback process. He seemed a little concerned about it at first, and every time he went off even a little bit, he would throw up his hands in horror and feel that all is lost. When a couple of times he was out of sync, and he would apologize profusely, oh, I'm sorry, you know, and that sort of thing, and almost to the point of, you know, like a little kid who's been chastised.
Well, it's a one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready now, go, 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 but don't you step on my blue suede shoe. Well, you can do anything but take the help of my blue suede shoe. Well, it's blue, blue, blue suede shoes, blue, blue, blue suede shoes, yeah, blue, blue, blue suede shoes, baby, blue, blue, blue suede shoes. Well, you can do anything but take hold of my blue suede shoes.
It was really quite a remarkable thing to watch him and to see this and feel this this electricity, whatever, that he radiated, and he really had that.
The screen test proved that Elvis looked great on camera. The question was, could he act? To find out, Mr. Wallace ordered a second test. The scene chosen was from Richard Nash's acclaimed stage drama, The Rainmaker. These photographs are the only record of that crucial screen test.
It was a part of Jimmy Curry, which was a scene from The Rainmaker, which Wallace was then casting. He did a very good job of it. He was more than competent. Wallace naturally was very much enthused, and he knew that Elvis was going somewhere, and he of course would have liked to have signed him to an exclusive 7-year contract like he did so many other people. And of course the Colonel was not about to have that.
For a short time, Elvis Presley thought that The Rainmaker was going to be his first acting role.
We'll have a movie coming out, I don't know when, but we started making it in June. It's a movie with Burt Lancaster and Katharine Hepburn called The Rainmaker.
Ultimately, this was not to be.
I suppose the reason he was not used in the film is that it was not a lead part. And as Wallace would say, at those prices, it's got to be a lead, you know.
Mr. Wallace and the Colonel agreed on a non-exclusive contract, which Elvis signed on April the 6th. The agreement called for Elvis to make 7 movies over 7 years for a total salary of $2.3 million. All they needed now was an appropriate screenplay.
Of course, it's a dream come true, you know. Everything, something I never think would happen to me, of all people, but it was Paramount Pictures and it's a 7-year contract. I've had people ask me, was I going to sing in the movies? I'm not. Not as far as I know, because I took a strictly an acting test, and I wouldn't care too much about singing in the movies.
In 1956, Hollywood's domination of the entertainment industry was being challenged by a new medium known as television. The king of this new medium was Milton Berle, and on April 3rd, Elvis made his debut appearance on Uncle Milty's nationally broadcast TV show. It was the first of many televised appearances that Elvis would make over the next 4 months.
Here's a young man who in a few short months has gained tremendous popularity in the music business. His records are really gone like wildfire. He's America's new singing sensation, our new RCA recording artist. Here he is, tribute section for Elvis Presley.
Well, since my baby left me, will I find a new place to dwell? Well, it's down at the end of Lonely Street at Heartbreak Hotel.
Milton Berle was just fantastic. I mean, he made everybody feel so comfortable. With Uncle Milty on the set, I mean, just go for broke. Milton just let him go. In fact, got out and joined him.
Well, it's one for the money.
You know, the wilder the better.
It's been said that 40 million viewers tuned in to this television show. 40 million potential moviegoers. A clear demonstration of the phenomenal power of this new medium. Colonel Parker was not about to miss an opportunity to capitalize on this exposure and immediately organized a series of nationwide appearances. On television, Elvis continued to draw huge ratings, and with each appearance, his popularity grew. A return engagement on the Milton Berle Show made front page news, and this was followed by an equally memorable performance on the Steve Allen Show. In July, Colonel Parker negotiated a record-breaking fee of $50,000 for 3 appearances on the Ed Sullivan Show. Elvis was now more popular than ever. He had a string of number one hit singles, and it seemed that the image of Elvis Presley was everywhere. He even appeared on TV interviewer High Gardner's nationally syndicated talk show and spoke about one of his favorite actors, James Dean.
I would never compare myself in any way to James Dean because James Dean was a genius in acting.
Uh-huh.
Although I'll say that that I sure would like to. I mean, I guess there's a lot of actors in Hollywood that would like to. I've had the ability that James Dean had, but I would never compare myself with James Dean in any way.
Elvis had been on the road for 4 months straight and decided to take a much-needed break. He and his buddies loaded up his mama's brand new pink Cadillac and drove to Biloxi, Mississippi for a 2-week vacation with his girlfriend, June Juanico.
My mother's boyfriend at the time had a friend that owned a charter boat. So he invited him to go on a fishing trip. He said, I'll take care of everything. And he asked Elvis, what type of beer would you like? And Elvis didn't drink beer and told him, any kind you want, it gets fine. I don't drink beer. So he decides, well, if Elvis don't drink beer, we won't have beer on the boat. But anyhow, Elvis enjoyed the fishing trip so much because, I mean, we just knocked the fish dead. We had at least 100 fish that we brought in, big fish, sharks, bonitas, 60-pound fish, you know, and just fight with them all day. We got away from the fishing crowd and went to spend some alone time on top of the boat. But Elvis was getting so sunburned, he should have never got on the top of the boat, you know, no shade. But, well, you don't want to know what we did on top of the boat, do you?
Hal Wallace had yet to find a suitable screenplay for Elvis, and the decision was made to loan him out to 20th Century Fox.
Mr. Wallace was not only a shrewd businessman, but a shrewd showman. And he wasn't convinced that Presley was able to carry a picture. So he loaned him out to Fox, made enough money himself to make it worth his while, But also he found out that Presley was a presence on the screen and he was a drawing power.
Elvis Presley returned to Hollywood on August the 17th. A few days later, he reported to Fox Studios and began production on Love Me Tender, a Civil War drama about two brothers who fall for the same girl.
It was a straight acting part. That was fine because there was no singing and he was tickled. He was real tickled about that. Elvis already had three gold records at this time. Elvis didn't have to sing. Elvis wanted to act.
I've heard all your lies and believed them just like you wanted me to. Like the night you stood there, I wanted to cry and saying it was only a bad dream. And then yesterday at the schoolhouse when you ran away from me because of something you advanced and said.
No, Clint, listen, I'm not...
Stop it, Clint! Give her a chance! For what, to deny it? She can't. Go on, say it, Kathy. Say I'm lying. Say you want your lover. Say you ain't laid awake every night by my side thinking of him. Wishing I was Vance. Wishing you'd waited for him and never married me.
Shut up, Clint. There ain't none of it so.
Tell me he's never had you in his arms since you came back. Tell me he hasn't kissed
you. Oh, stop it, Clint. You're hurting.
You can't say it because it's true.
A lot of people don't know that Elvis actually studied movies. He told me that he used to go to the neighborhood theaters, and for hours he would watch Tony Curtis, Clark Gable, Jimmy Dean, Brando, and he would pick out little things. And he told me that he went in with a lot of confidence, and he knew that he could do it. He said, I know I can do it.
You're trying to protect yourself!
He said, I knew that I just had to go out there and be myself. And he said, if it came off, it came off. If it didn't, it didn't.
Love Me Tender was originally called the Reno Brothers and contained no singing. But the studio didn't think it would make much sense to put the world's biggest singing star in a movie and not have him sing. Much to Elvis Presley's surprise, 20th Century Fox added four songs to the picture.
Well, the first song that they added was Love Me Tender. He called me that night and he told me about the song and he sang it to me over the telephone. And he said, it's a pretty song. What do you think about it? I said, I think it's a beautiful song. And he said, that's all right. I can handle that much, you know.
Love me tender, love me sweet. Never let me go.
Then he called and he was just raising holy hell because he said that they've thrown in some garbage, these damn silly songs, and it was a big problem for him. Even his band wasn't even there. And that was a big disappointment, too.
Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill.
And he said that's going to be, they've also changed the name of the movie to Love Me Tender to go along with the song, and they're going to make it the theme song throughout with just instrumental, and I'm going to be singing it.
Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill.
I had a feeling when I watched him that he was really singing that to his own mother. And everybody, there were tears in everybody's eyes. It was so beautiful. And he was able to come across like that.
You didn't have to talk to Elvis to understand that acting meant a great deal to him.
Get away from him! Leave him alone!
You knew when you worked with him that he was tremendously focused on what he was doing. He was really into his character. My girlfriend, Dolores Hart, told me that Elvis had mentioned to her that his mother was not happy with that scene from Love Me Tender where he dies. She was very upset over that.
Don't move. Just lie still.
Kid. Where's Vance? I gotta talk to him.
Right here, Clint.
Vance, I didn't mean it.
I know you didn't, Clint. You don't have to tell me. Everything's gonna be all right.
Thank you.
Elvis and I were walking back from seeing the rushes. I said, Elvis, how do you like the movie? He says, it's going to be mighty sad. They're going to kill me in the end.
Elvis and his mom weren't the only ones upset by his on-screen demise. Colonel Parker, mindful of fan reaction, wasn't too thrilled about it either. Fox ordered the ending reshot. In the new ending, Elvis still dies, but his image remains on screen, conveying the idea that the spirit of Clint Reno lives on.
Happiness will follow you everywhere you go.
We had gone to a dinner party with some well-to-do friends of Mr. and Mrs. Presley. After we got through eating, there was a private screening, and this was the first time that Elvis got to see himself on the big screen. So he was amazed at the size of himself when he was up there, you know, and he'd never looked better. And his mother was just tickled, you know, because he looked so good up there. And even his acting was damn good for not having any lessons. Damn good.
3 months after the cameras first rolled, Love Me Tender premiered in New York City. The date was November the 16th, 1956. Thousands of fans jammed the streets around the Paramount Theater. The gathering was a newsreel publicity stunt arranged by the master showman, Colonel Tom Parker. Critically, the reviews were mixed at best. Nevertheless, the picture was a huge commercial success, recovering production costs in just under 3 weeks. 6 years earlier, Elvis Presley had been a movie theater usher. Now, he was a movie star.
I remember the sign above the Paramount Theater at Broadway and 43rd Street. I don't know how tall it was, but it was like a number of stories high. It was an enormous sign. It just, that was it for Broadway. I mean, it was the biggest sign I'd ever seen in my life. And that was his first film.
Following the isolation of a movie set, Elvis was anxious to get back to what he loved, performing live. One of his first stops was his birthplace, Tupelo, Mississippi, where he dazzled 7,500 hometown fans. As usual, the crowd went wild, and despite the presence of 100 National Guardsmen, a number of the kids managed to climb on stage.
In his opinion, he said, the kids behave like that because they're not allowed to cut up in school. They're not allowed to do crazy things at home. They want to get up and jump and dance and scream and let out some of these pent-up emotions that they have. And this was their outlet. He said, it's not me personally. It's an opportunity for this gathering to get together and act like a bunch of just crazy, wild, happy kids.
Just about everything Elvis Presley did at this point in his life seemed to generate controversy. Despite the negative press, his meteoric rise continued. He received his fifth gold record for Don't Be Cruel, and Colonel Parker negotiated a merchandising deal that allowed Elvis's image to be emblazoned on everything from lipstick to lunchboxes. By the fall of 1956, Elvis had it made. According to Variety, he was a millionaire. Colonel Parker had kept his promise and turned the young star's $1 million worth of talent into $1 million. After spending Christmas at home with his family, Elvis returned to Hollywood. Because of the huge crowds waiting to catch a glimpse of their hero at LA's Union Station, he was forced to disembark before the train reached the terminal. The popular controversy over Elvis's sexy, rebellious image and its effect on teenagers was not lost on Hollywood. Hal Wallace turned it into an advantage and tied it to the plot of his next film, Loving You.
Loving You, the first big modern musical built around the fiery personality of Elvis Presley.
Yes.
Follow him through the barnstorming day and the one-night stand. The big moment when the girls discovered him and he discovered girls. See what happens when a down-to-earth kid goes too high, too fast.
Loving You was the first film written specifically for Elvis. The picture contained an album's worth of songs, and its loosely biographical plot was one that would be rehashed throughout his entire film career.
What I can do for you. You don't care about me or Tex or anybody, just yourself.
You've got 15 minutes to get on that stage and find out if you've even got a future.
Prior to beginning production, Hal Wallace sent the film's writer-director to Memphis in order to observe, firsthand the real Elvis Presley.
I had come to Memphis to meet Elvis. One of his cousins or his hangers-on was trying to convince me that Elvis was already a very good actor. And his friend said, man, that screen test ain't nothing. You ought to hear him do his piece. Elvis said, nah, I don't want to. He said, go ahead, do the piece. And I said, what piece are you talking about? He said, oh, it's a little something I learned. He said, it was General MacArthur's speech to Congress, his farewell speech. I said, why did you learn that? He says, I don't know, I just to see if I could memorize it, and I did.
I said 8 o'clock, you're a half hour late. That's no way to start a career.
Well, I wasn't gonna come, but I got fired this morning. Somebody complained I was late making a delivery.
Well, that's too bad, Deke. But maybe it's all for the best.
Y'all still want me to come with you?
Us all sure do, honey. Peck, you remember Deke Rivers?
Hi. So this is your gimmick.
Meet Tex officially, Deke. When you get to know him, you'll love him. But there's no hurry.
He didn't ask me very much about the script. What he asked me was, do I have to smile very much in the picture? And I said, well, I don't recall offhand. Why? Why would you ask a question like that? He said, because I've been studying a lot of actors. He said, and I found guys like Bogart and Jimmy Dean and Marlon Brando. He said, they don't smile very much. He says, and I'd like not to be able to smile.
11 years ago, the night the home burned, when everybody was milling around and yelling, well, I ran away. I ran all night, and the next morning I found myself in here. I was all alone, Miss Clinton. And the one thing I needed was friends. I knew I never wanted to go back to that home. So I buried Jimmy Tompkins here and took on Deke's name. And I figured on taking on his friends, too. And ever since, I've been running. Running and stumbling and crawling, looking for a friend. Trying to deserve this man's name.
When the word got out that I was going to write and direct a picture with Elvis, I began getting phone calls at my house. I got a number of telephone calls from people who said, how dare you put this instrument of the devil on our screen? Don't foster this dreadful music and this dreadful man. Then I began getting mail saying that this Antichrist should not be encouraged, and that was an extension of what was really happening around the country.
I got a woman here, she can be. I got a woman here, she can be. Sometimes I think she's almost beyond me. A black cat up died of fright, 'cause she crossed his path last night. I got a woman mean as she can be. Sometimes I think she's almost mean as me. Kissed so hard, she blew my lips. Hurt so good, my heart just slipped.
Elvis knew that he wasn't doing anything wrong. I mean, he asked me, do you think I'm vulgar? My mother thought he was precious. She thought he was a fine young man, and that was just his way of expressing himself with all the rhythm that he had to go with his music, and there wasn't a thing vulgar about the man.
She makes love without a smile. Ooh, her dog get drive me wild. I got a woman who means that she can be. I'm loving she's all over me. Sometimes I think she's almost mean as me.
Well, we really couldn't understand, what we do wrong. Now, we were known as Elvis Presley and the Rakius Trio there for a while. We had to go look, what does Rakius mean, What did we do?
So
Some people like to rock, some people like to roll, but moving and a grooving gonna satisfy my soul and have a party.
Hal Wallace insisted that Loving You reflect the realities of Elvis Presley's life whenever possible. So much so that, unlike Love Me Tender, in this film, Elvis's band members were included in the performance sequences of the picture.
We had our own instruments on the set. Elvis usually had a prop guitar, but he'd always have his own guitar around somewhere. So while they're doing lighting or whatever, he'd ease over to the electrician and say, "Get Scotty some electricity up for his amp." And they would, and we'd start jamming. And then all the crew would stop and start gathering around. It was a jam session.
They would frequently jam around and have fun themselves and amuse other people. But quite often, I must say, I would ask them, "Please, will you stop that? We're trying to do some work here." To my shame, I guess.
There's a moon that's big and bright in the Milky Way tonight. But the way you act, and everyone knows that.
As Loving You neared completion, Elvis got a real surprise. His mom and dad came to Hollywood, and Hal Cantor put them in the picture.
Vernon and Gladys came to Hollywood, I guess, for the first time. Anyway, I said, "Now I have an idea. When we do the big show scene, why don't we put your folks in the audience?" And he said, "They'd love it. They'd love it. Let's do that." And that's how they got into the picture.
And no one, I'd rather do it with than it ain't you.
Someone told me that years later, after his mother died, Elvis never wanted to see that picture again. Never watched it. So I was told.
Elvis and his mother shared an extraordinary bond. The devotion that existed between the two was obvious to everyone that knew them.
It was something because you could see the love between these two. I mean, the love from this lady's eyes. She thought Elvis was born to do great things. This was God's gift to her. He took Jesse away. And so Elvis had the power of two people that he was living for, his twin brother and himself. Constantly, she worried about him. And she had days when she felt like it was all, one of these days she was gonna wake up and everything was gonna be gone. And she was afraid something was going to happen to Elvis.
She, I think, was concerned for him getting hurt or a wreck on the road like any mother would be. When it was just the three of us, Bill, myself, and Elvis traveling in the car, and we go to pick Elvis up, well, she'd always call me over to the side and say, "Now, take care of my boy, and y'all be careful on the road." He wasn't what a lot of people read, that he was a mama's boy. That was not true. They were just very close.
At this point in his life, Elvis could buy anything he wanted. What he wanted most was a secure home for himself and his mom and dad. In March of 1957, he bought Graceland. Behind the gates of the antebellum mansion, Elvis Presley was safe from the prying eyes of the world.
I remember discussing a couple of things with him in which, out of the blue, he expressed a desire to be able to just go down the corner and have a hamburger. But by then it was too late. Even if he wanted to do something about it, I don't think he could have. The snowball was already rolling, and he was just too famous too fast. He was already so famous that there was no way for the snowball not to continue down the hill.
While Elvis was settling into Graceland, Colonel Tom Parker was in Hollywood finalizing a deal with Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. Elvis would receive $250,000 and a piece of the profits for his portrayal of Vince Everett in Jailhouse Rock. Profit participation was a demand that only the biggest stars could make.
You know, Elvis had worked at 20th, he'd worked at Paramount, but MGM was king of the hill at that time, and I never forget, as we came under those gates, I said, "Good God, Elvis, MGM."
I was sitting in my office the first day that he came in, and I got a call from the cop at the gate who said, you know, we got a real problem down here. We can't handle it. All these people are all over, and I can't handle the women. They're going crazy. And I said, well, you know, you've chased kids away before. And he said, I'm not talking about kids. I'm talking about executive secretaries out of the Thalberg building.
The first day, we all went out together. Elvis and a couple of his buddies were in one car, and we were in the limousine, and when it went on the lot, secretaries and people started coming out of buildings, lining this little street. And then we said, my Lord, what's going on, you know? It was amazing, it really was.
How's your headache?
I'm getting all unglued.
Wherever the girls thought he was, they would assemble. It was surprising how level-headed he was about it, because he was so young. And I remember distinctly when I said to Elvis, Elvis, how do you feel about all of this? Isn't it fantastic? He says, tomorrow I may not be worth a nickel. To have that kind of adulation at this age and to be able to take it the way he did was remarkable.
You don't like crazy music. You don't like rocking bands. You just want to go to a movie show and sit there holding hands. You're so square. Baby, I don't care. You don't like a hard rod racing, driving late at night.
If anybody remembers the swimming pool scene, and we're doing Baby, I Don't Care. We did this all one afternoon. And they would do close-ups, and then they'd back off and do the long shots. Well, by the time they got to those, the sun had got in a position it was shining right in on the set. So every time you see a long shot, I've got sunglasses on. But if you see these two little black dots, and then when I go to close-up, they're gone. I've always thought that was hilarious.
Baby, I don't care. Baby, I don't care. Baby, I don't care. Baby, I don't care.
Over the years, Jailhouse Rock would become one of Elvis Presley's best-known films. As in Loving You, the picture had a semi-biographical plot.
I don't know why my heart flips. I only know it does. I wonder why I love you, baby. I guess it's just because you're so square. Baby, I don't care.
Jailhouse Rock focused on the darker side of Elvis's image. In the movie, he plays a brooding ex-con who finds himself thrust into the ultra-hip world of Hollywood.
I'm not sure how much of a chance he got to demonstrate all of his acting abilities, because the material was obviously selected to be Elvis Presley product.
Lizzie.
You might at least ask me what happened this afternoon.
What happened this afternoon?
I sold your record, that's all.
Swell. I could tear into a good steak.
Would it hurt you just to say that you're happy about it?
Well, it wouldn't be easy. When the money starts rolling in, then I'll say I'm happy.
I don't think he was ever challenged. I don't think he ever had to play a terribly difficult scene so you could compare him to another actor.
You like burgundy? It goes great with steak.
I like anything that goes with steak. I'm broke.
Well, if it's all right with you, I'll pay for the meal.
You will if we eat. Hey, waitress.
If you could say Elvis was ever unhappy about something, I think secretly he was very unhappy that he'd get more of an opportunity to act. He wished they would give him a little more freedom to do other types of things, you know. And there was a certain drama about Jailhouse Rock, which was good for Elvis. It was a naturalness about it that made him a good actor, and it's a shame he didn't get roles that would show that off to a greater advantage.
Most critics felt that Elvis's performance in Jailhouse Rock was the best work he had done thus far. However, not everything he did made it into the final version of the film. These outtakes from the picture have been sitting undisturbed in a film storage vault since 1957 and have never before been seen by the public. Many of these scenes demonstrate Elvis's dedication to his craft.
He was the kind of person, if you had your druthers, that you'd work with every day. He was so dedicated, and he was so focused. He knew what it was about. He knew what tomorrow's work was going to be. He certainly knew what the film business was about. As far as the cast was concerned, he was very careful to show everybody that he respected their ability and that he was a rookie. When the scene was done, Elvis was very careful to go in front of the crew, not for the crew's benefit, because he meant it, to say, you know, thank you very much for your patience. I don't even know why you work with a kid who doesn't even understand acting, but I appreciate it. He wasn't doing it to show off, he was doing it because he understood that he needed them and he had to interact with them. And if the actor, no matter who it was, if he or she said, I think it would be better if I played it over on this side of the room, he'd say, fine. When he hit makeup in the morning, he got coffee for the makeup and hair people first, then he got it for the co-star, and then he got his own. And the other pleasure, of course, was that you were working with a very bright guy with a great sense of humor.
Now that's a C major chord. That's a big one. Now try the G. You will never make a guitar player. You got no rhythm in your bones.
Well, I never heard of anybody paying money to hear a guitar player.
Well, don't pay any attention to me. I was only in the business for 10 years, that's all.
Yeah, I read you.
The first time Elvis appeared on screen without his trademark pompadour, fans were astonished.
My first meeting, of course, was in order to discuss this matter of the haircut, which he was to have in one sequence of the picture. And as I had previously been informed, we could not touch one lock of Elvis's hair, so we will make a wig and then cover the sideburns as well. In order to make a wig that fits this well, it's a good idea to have a cast of the person's own head shape. Now when this hardens, of course, you have a perfect form of the person's head. However, you can't remove it, so you have to make a cut on one side. To do that cut, you use surgical shears. My assistant said, well, I'll make the cut. So he gets these and he makes the cut and he says, I think I cut his hair.
There was a quiet moment because hair started to fall all over Elvis's shoulder and nobody said a word. And finally Elvis looked at his shoulder and said, God, there's Frankie Avalon fans every place.
Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer was known throughout the world for its motion picture musicals. From Busby Berkeley to Gene Kelly and Fred Astaire, MGM had created many of the most innovative dance sequences ever filmed. However, nothing in their past prepared them for Elvis Presley, and no one at the studio had ever tried to choreograph rock and roll.
This is exactly the way it came down. I never forget Alex Romero was a choreographer. We'd had lunch that day, and then we went to one of those little rehearsal halls. Alex gets out there and he puts on the song Jailhouse Rock, and he goes through these Gene Kelly, Fred Astaire routines. And Elvis looked at me, and I looked at Elvis and Cliff, and Elvis said, hey man, that ain't me. So Alex, being such a sharp guy, he said, Elvis, he said, have you got any of your records in your dressing room? And so we put the records on. Elvis says, don't be cruel, hound dog. And he said, Elvis, he said, there's nobody here, and I know this is going to be hard for you to do. But he said, would you just show me what you do on stage? So Elvis went through about three songs. And Alex Romero said, I got it. See you later. And Elvis said, what do you mean you got it? He said, Elvis, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go home tonight, and I'm going to take what you do and work it into the routine. And it's going to be you, what you normally feel comfortable doing on stage, but I'm going to choreograph it.
The whole rhythm section was a purple game.
The next day, we come back, man, and we go back to that same little rehearsal hall. And Alex Romero, man, bless his heart, he's choreographed this scene. It looks like you're watching Elvis. So Elvis went through it, and man, it was, boom, they had it. And it worked out to be the best dancer we can see ever did.
One threw a party in the county jail. The prison band was there, they began to wail. The band was jumping and the joint began to swing. You should have heard the knocked out jailbird sing. Let it rock, everybody, let it rock. Everybody in the wholesale block was dancing to the jail out rock. Spider Murphy played a little saxophone. Little Joe was blowing on the slide trombone. The drummer for the metal door was crash, boom, bang. The whole rhythm section was a purple gang. Let's rock, everybody, let's rock. Everybody in the wholesale block.
It was funny because he enjoyed it so much. He was having such a good time. He also knew that he was doing a good number. He had a sense for the kill. He knew that this was going to look good.
I want to stick around a while and get my kick. Everybody, let's rock. Everybody knows they're rock. Put down to the jail.
I think from time to time he showed real sparks, but I don't feel that he ever was allowed to develop. But I felt that he was an incredible natural actor and could have been brilliant had he had Stella Adler or what's his name from the act, Lee Strasberg
or Meisner.
Or Sandy Meisner. If any one of those guys had gotten a hold of him, it would have been all over. I think it would have been as good as Brando.
You insulted my father, my mother, and me, and it's just unforgivable.
What do you expect? I come out, have a little beer. First thing you know, some old broads push me in the corner with some stupid question.
They were just trying to bring you into the conversation.
I could show their conversation. I'm not even sure they were talking English.
I'll drive you back to your hotel.
I'll walk.
I think I'm going to just hate you.
You ain't going to hate me. I ain't gonna let you hate me.
How dare you think such cheap tactics would work with me?
I ain't tactics, honey. It's just a beast in me.
Elvis's co-star in this picture was a promising young actress named Judy Tyler. The two quickly became close friends.
He had tremendous respect for Judy as an actress, whose career was snapped short because of an accident. The collision killed the driver of the other car, her and her husband. Strangely enough, both vehicles were looted. And the whole thing was extremely ugly, and I think that it was very disturbing, obviously to everybody, but I think it was disturbing to Elvis, too, because it was such a horrible freak accident.
I never forget, I was getting out of bed, my mom said, Elvis is at the door. So I went to the door, and I said, Elvis. And he said, come on. I said, what's wrong? He said, we're going to take a ride. And he looked real serious. I said, damn, what's wrong? So we got in the car, and he said, hey, man. He told me, he said, Judy Tyler got killed. And I said, God, Elvis, what happened? And he proceeded to explain to me there's a car wreck, and he said he felt so bad because she had been a child actress, and this was her first big break, and she was so excited about it. And she got killed before the picture came out. And Elvis was very upset about it.
You're so young and beautiful. You're everything I love. Your angel smile, your gentle touch are all I'm dreaming of. Oh, take this heart I offer you and never set me free. Then you'll be
forever young and beautiful too.
He was terrific in that picture. He had a naturalism about him, and he never seemed to have to push. It was a very much a part of his nature, his own nature. I think Elvis had the makings of a great actor.
With the completion of Jailhouse Rock, Elvis Presley was gaining credibility as a serious actor. The picture was released to generally positive reviews and quickly recovered its production costs. The outsider from Memphis was now in with Hollywood's in crowd, though Colonel Parker was mindful of the influence of strangers.
The Colonel kept an almost total net around Elvis. And I'm not sure to what degree Elvis needed that net or wanted that net, but it was protective up to a point for Elvis, I'm sure. But he didn't want anybody to get close enough to Elvis to exercise any kind of influence other than his own. He had a golden goose, and he wanted to keep turning out the same eggs.
He was sort of like bigger than life, you know, cigar, hail fellow well met. Sit down, boy, have yourself a whatever. He was sort of like that.
Elvis Presley thought that the Colonel was probably the best manager in show business. He knew that the Colonel was making a few little mistakes here, a little mistakes there, but there was no record to go by. You couldn't go to a library and get a reference book on how to manage a rock and roll star, because Elvis was the first. So he knew that by and large, Colonel was doing 95% of the things right, maybe 5% of the things wrong. But Elvis accepted that, and he always said, hey, he said, the guy got me this far, made me a big star, I'm gonna stick with him.
On December 23, 1957, Elvis Presley received his draft notice. He was told to report for induction at 7:45 a.m. on January 20th.
I never will forget, we were at Graceland. I walked in. First thing he did was hand me the envelope. I said, what's this? He said, read it. And I opened it up and it said, greetings, you know? And I said, oh, no, Elvis. He said, yeah, I've been drafted. I said, damn, what are we gonna do? He said, man, I don't know. He said, the Colonel says we might can get a deferment to make King Creole, but he says, probably gotta go. I said, well, man, there's no war going on. You're sitting on the top of the world, and all of a sudden, you gotta go in the army. Didn't make sense.
Elvis was given a 2-month deferment in order to complete his fourth motion picture. The film was crafted by the acclaimed director, Michael Curtiz, creator of such classics as the Humphrey Bogart masterpiece, Casablanca. This would be Elvis Presley's finest film, King Creole. Based on the best-selling novel, A Stone for Danny Fisher, the story had originally been purchased by Hal Wallace with James Dean in mind.
Get out of here, Ronnie! Don't come back!
Following Dean's untimely death, the part was given to Elvis, and the lead role was changed from a boxer to a singer.
He said, I want to do a damn good job. He said, because I know it's a good script, a good director, and a good supporting cast. He said, this is what I've been looking for.
Boy, you're a pretty fancy performer, ain't you, kid?
Now you know what I do for an encore. Come on, get out of here.
The bottom line was, he was going into the Army. He didn't know what would happen after the Army. And he said, man, rock and roll could be gone, because we had seen Calypso come and go, we'd seen the Mambo come and go, and all those fads come and go. And to be honest, we didn't know if rock and roll was a fad. We really didn't. So he said, rock and roll may be gone when I get out of the Army. So if I do a good job on King Creole, then if rock and roll fades out, I can still come back to Hollywood and make motion pictures.
Crawfish, crawfish. See, I got 'em, see the size. Stripped and cleaned before your eyes. Sweet meat, look. Fresh and ready to cook. Crawfish, crawfish.
Curtiz was very excited about working with him. After they started working, he didn't want Elvis. Curtiz went to a theater and saw Elvis and said, no, no, I'm not going to do it. And finally, Hal Wallace said, look, this kid, you know, the teenagers love him, but he wants other people to have a great deal of respect for him. So he said, I want you to work with him and make him the actor that he wants to be.
Is that what I brought you up to do, to fight?
No, Paul, that's not what you brought me up to do, but I stopped listening to you. I ran out of other cheeks. You know, I remember once, Pop, when I was no more than 3 feet high, you took me to the circus. You accidentally bumped into some guy, and he turned around and punched you. He punched you right in the mouth, and you know what you did? Nothing. Nothing. When they swing at you, Pop, it's not enough to duck. You gotta swing back. Maybe you can't anymore, but I'm not taking after you. You go to school. I'm going out and make a buck.
I think that Elvis really wanted this to be his ultimate goal, is to be a great actor. He took the very seriously his role. And he lost sleep over it. He would take his script to bed with him, and he would come in and was very concentrated, very focused on playing Danny. And I think Danny was very close to him.
Hello, Mr. Fields. Hello there.
Could I get by, please?
Don't you,
You? That's Maxie Fields. That's your boss. Are you crazy?
Hey, Mr. Fields, how about that, huh?
Who's this guy, Ryan?
The king of Yugoslavia. How should I know?
Take your hand off my arm, Mr. Fields.
How come you're so friendly with the lady, boy?
Well, we met in Paris last year. The king of France introduced us.
You're a pretty fresh boy, aren't you?
Mr. Fields,
I think that everybody on the set was amazed at how good Elvis was.
How you feeling?
I remember hearing him going up to Mr. Curtiz and said something to the effect that, for the first time, I know what a director is. And Curtiz was really pleased about that. Curtiz said he thought Elvis was going to be a very conceited boy. And when he started working with him, he said, no, this is a lovely boy. And he's a wonderful actor. And he's going to be a great actor.
You know, that's a pretty piece of material. You ought to have a dress made out of it.
Don't you like it?
I love it. And hey, what do you say we get together sometime and sing all the old songs or anything else you want to do?
Oh, I'd like to. I can't. I'd really like to, but I can't.
I get it.
Maybe we'll meet someplace by accident.
You tell me where you think the accident will take place, and I'll make sure I'm there.
It'll take place. Just don't rush it.
I'll be waiting.
You better go now.
Well, what's a big rush?
Maxie will be here any minute. You better go.
You remember in the cab when you wouldn't leave until I kissed you? Well, I'm standing right here until you kiss me.
I think Elvis became the actor he wanted to be in King Creole.
I'll see you sometime.
I think everything after that was downhill. What happened was that they were selling records with these movies, and he wasn't able to do the dramatic roles that he wanted to do.
Danny, I wish you wouldn't go.
This isn't the accident, honey. The accident happened that first morning in the Blue Shade. From then on, everything's been fixed. It's like a crooked fight. And you're wrong about the heart. I do miss it. I miss it so much as a girl I may marry just because she has one to give me.
I'm not asking you to marry me.
Well, you're asking me something. You're a little tight, aren't you?
I think he could have been meant for Hollywood had he been given an opportunity. If he wouldn't have been just a piece of clay in the hands of all the big shots, I think he could have made it.
King Creole.
He's a man in New Orleans, plays a rock and roll. He's a guitar man with a great big soul. He lays down a beat like a ton of cola. He goes by the name of King Creole. You know,
in a strange way, he was perfect for Hollywood. And in another terrible way, he was what I would consider a casualty of Hollywood. He was perfect for Hollywood in that they could put him in anything, and he would draw. And he was victimized by Hollywood for the same reason.
He sang some blues about New Orleans.
Elvis never went to the last stage, as far as I could see. And it was not his fault. He was given very little meaningful material. And part of that is my fault. I did what I was told to do, and that was, you know, give him a framework with for 12 songs and a romantic background and lots of girls, and that's it. I felt he was capable of more. They knew that he was capable of more. There's no question in my mind that he could have been a much, much greater actor than he was. There's just no question about it.
Get up on your feet when he gets a rockin' fever, baby, heaven sinks. He don't stop playing till his guitar breaks. You know he's gone, 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 jumping like a cat. Oh, yeah. You know he's gone, 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 and a pepper chicken came real. You know he's gone, gone, gone.
Presley was meant for Hollywood. He sure was, because a lot of people got to see him on the big wide screen. When you're on that CinemaScope screen, it just has something that is just bigger than life, and that's what Elvis was, bigger than life.
I will spend my whole life loving you, just loving you. Winter, summer, springtime too, loving you, loving you. Makes no difference where I go or what I do. You know that I'll always be loving you, just you. If I'm seen with someone new, don't be blue, don't you be blue. I'll be faithful, I'll be true, always true, true to you. There is only one, and you know, you know that I'd always be loving you.
Any place is paradise when I'm with you. Whether we're standing on your doorstep, or sitting in a park, or strolling down a shady lane, or dancing in the dark, where I can take you in my arms and look into your pretty eyes. Any place is paradise when I'm with you. Fine.
Any place is paradise when